So here we've got incredible reds, wonderful reds, and wonderful big scale prints. I love the fact that you're putting these big flowers and that big rolling serpentine pattern works very well. And the paint pots are great. This went through lots of different machinations. We have the whites and darks, the darks and whites. We're going through all kinds of things. But eventually she decided that because the colors were all very, very close, she wasn't getting enough definition. So she started bringing in some more punchy darks. And that made some of the things that were darks become lights. And that's the thing that can happen in this quilt, being open for that happening.
Three different borders?
Lots of choices. This is probably too dark for here.
Yeah. You mentioned the back.
And this is jolly, and it could be fun if you're up for a while. this is elegantly beautiful and perfect for the level of color and, you know, what's happening in the quilt. You've got kind of like a succulent garden, beautiful, soft, glassy greens. I love the way this shocking pink comes through there and just it sits in there perfectly, doesn't it? And it kind of talks to the other little chinks of pink that come in, by the way.
It's very subtle, that quilt. It's beautiful.
Yes.
It reminds me of that Vaseline glass that you used to get in the...
Yeah. It was very tempting to put in things that were too dark, because they were great colors. She had some wonderful colors, but they were just too dark. And every time she put something in, it just stabbed a hole in it, because it wanted to be this, but it has to be, but also has the feeling of beautiful, you know, gorgeous green apples and lovely leaves and this. Very nice. And I love the way she played with big prints coming through here. This is wonderful at Brandon's. And that wonderful rope design.
And there's one fabric that I'm so glad that Kate doesn't notice I've flipped. And this fabric, which reminds me of rabbit droppings, this kid, in case you hadn't noticed, I found it was a little bit too dank, a little too heavy, and I was so enjoying the scent of, this reminds me of celery sticks, or that kind of clean lined notes. And I felt when she flipped it over, it just had a softer, kind of lighter glow.
Yeah. And then she's got that nice, heraldic border. So, this went up in about 10 minutes flat, and I just got rearranged until it's just exquisite. It has wonderful, wonderful jazz in it. I love my zigzag. I've never liked this print so much as I like it on this quilt. It just adds a wonderful curry spice and flavor to it. And then she's used this enormous, great, big brocade print of mine, which cuts up very nicely. I mean, I love the way that looks in there. The drama it gives. And then she echoes that drama with this big, strong stripe. Another strong stripe and another strong stripe. So that gives us this wonderful kind of structure. The playfulness of these little, you know, smaller motifs just dancing around. And then the great big circles of these flowers, the circles of the paint pots and the circles of the baskets. Wonderful, the way that's all playing together. And that's a very important thing too, to kind of, when you get the color settled, start to think about those patterns and how they play and the echoes of shapes. This is one of the most exquisite quilts I've ever had in any of my workshops. It's just absolutely what I love when somebody goes to this extreme and does something so individual and so almost without color. I mean, It was taking a chance of going into the gray, galvanized, metallic world, but she put in these wonderful organic colors that just, it's filled with color. It's tonal, and it's
intriguing and the scale of things. Oh, she listened to me and walked out. She knew a good thing when she saw it. Good. Wonderful. The batiks have totally come into their own. They're absolutely beautiful in here. And then these tie-dye prints are wonderful. And look at the way that works with Philip Jacobs' wonderful tree peony. I mean, tree fungi. How that works. And anybody who was here yesterday would have seen this strange polka dot of tulip pinks went into almost every quilt yesterday, and it was amazing. It was amazing in dark blues and reds and everything else. Here she's got it in this kind of neutral palette where it is the punch and the drama absolutely speaks to that. I mean, absolutely wonderful.
This is the most important fabric in here. It just opens it up. Now, and with the border that came in here, it just allows it to grow up.
Yeah.
But as a point of observation, have you noticed that, how well it goes with this sign?
No, seriously.
It's all about
relationships. That is a very interesting idea. But here we have a two-color pattern. Happens to be a lady's gents. But that does work for that. And that's the kind of thing to watch out for.
Yeah.
What I find interesting is that she had some color, some lavenders and some blues and some greens, and they didn't need, when she took them out, this whole thing is so colorful. I just find it just vibrating with, tones and quality.
I hope you can find an old sheet of weathered corrugated iron to photograph this on.
Or a weathered barn.
So the question I have is, because all of the tulip pinks are all in that same angle. It's reading all in that same angle. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
What I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
So is that best thing to do, or could she have changed the somehow and made them like one over here?
On the lighter side.
Yeah.
I think what you're saying, it's kind of better to keep a consistency rather than kind of playing tricks on the eyes. It doesn't need it.
Okay.
Yep. Incredibly luminous, deep. And what's interesting is this could have gone quite pastel. We had some lovely pastels. And you could have taken it in that direction easily. Because I love pastel quilts. But there's something about this class that goes toward dark in the most wonderful way. We had some beautiful dark quilts yesterday, and this dark quilt is just so gorgeous because it's dark that the colors are really shining, and this becomes the lightest thing in it. And echoed by that little guinea flower. Beautiful. And I love the way that stripe works. Very, very nice, and I love that deep purple edge. I just think that's gorgeous as the border for that. And then here we have a lovely, scrappy, old-fashioned kind of quilt that just has this lovely, lacy kind of lavenders and blues, and then she brings in a lovely kind of warm autumn colors that are just lovely. And she had used this print, but that became a very nice idea for the border. And I think that's going to be beautiful, as that echoes everything that's in the quilt coming down.
It makes me think of a bag of marshmallows. Mm-hmm. you could place it
or
anywhere.
Sugared almonds.
Sugared almonds.
Very, very nice. And then a lovely rosy pinky story. It's kind of, going from this and going into the softer version of lovely, lovely pinks. I love pinks. So I find that this is very lush. I would love to see that as a tablecloth with a great big dish of watermelons. It'd be beautiful. And that's going to be a lovely border for that.
And also, notice how the border is going out like eyelashes. So it's going away rather than forming a line.
Now here we have, again, this beautiful soft green like we had over in the corner. But it's a little bit greener than kind of lime and gold, with touches of gold, which just work beautifully. And I think the scale of that border is going to be very pretty coming through there. But this has turned out absolutely lovely, and I love the way she's played with patterns. So we get nice big things happening. And that's so important. Have you all seen that the bigger scale prints, the more playful, primitive kind of prints, are what this really loves? This batik is gorgeous. And then, this just, every step of the way, this has been absolutely beautiful today. But she just kept improving it and improving it. I was thinking she was going to be finished biologically. Oh, it's just deep and rich. And it doesn't let up. It doesn't go pastel. The darkest quilt in the room. Absolutely velvety, rich darkness. And these batiks with that wonderful, piercing turquoise against purple was a wonderful note in here. This little geometric kind of burnished dark indigo is very good. I love the black behind that big daisy print. And then that big strong weave from India is just working a treat. I love the brown leaves on the cobalt coming through here, the warmth of that. And that's going to be a gorgeous border. Just dark and big globes of gorgeous color in the flowers.
I kind of feel like this is made of velvet. It's got that intensity.
It really does. If you had trouble sorting out your lights and darks, parts of this print are quite light. But if you're going to put it in this column, you've got to sort out the lighter bits and just have them there. Like that one would be fine up here. See what I'm talking about.
It's that kind of the fabric,
that darker one down there. So just be careful when you're doing things like that, because then it all gets confused as to what is your light and dark. You want your lovely dark shadow and then the bright light side. Not too
in the border key.
And the border is beautiful. Beautiful. These big peonies on a brocade background couldn't be better. This is very luminous. I'm so thrilled that she used my big ECAT, because a lot of people are just finding that too large, but it's not too large. Look at the way it fits into that diamond and just gives you that fresh punch of stripiness. Does anybody agree?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. There.
Good.
Good, and I love Brandon zigzag, the way that works. Love the big blue flower coming through here. She had it as a dark, and it really is a soft light in this context. So just sorting those things out is important. That, again, see, it's the same print. Isn't that interesting how color just changes something? That's the very same print, but seeing it in blue with the peony on the brocade background. Another wonderful, deep, rich, velvety blue, just wonderful. And I like the different things that she's got going here, like the gunmetal gray that's in here gives that a certain quality. Brandon's very fresh daisy is just wonderful in here. It just sparks the whole thing, and his dancing paisley does the same thing. And his elephant flower, you know, it's Brandon's fabrics are perfect for this kind of quilt. They're very kind of big, graphic, strong prints. And then we come to this gorgeous golden beast. Absolutely beautiful, like honey and amber and sunflowers and lemons and limes. Oh, just wonderful. And at first she was thinking about this border, but to me that's just a little bit too fresh and stabby. Isn't the softest that can be?
What's amazing is how this, except on the blues.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's what the ticket is, and now the pinks.
Yeah.
Pull out the pinks in here.
Yes, and the blues here.
That really
blues
is.
Here. Very nice.
Very
well,
nice.
I didn't even think about that. But that's great. And I love also that she used my batik. Again, something that people very rarely ever use, and I love the way it looks in there. It's hot. So I'm very happy with that little outcome. And then we end with the most lush and beautiful. And what's so beautiful about this piece is this batik, this kind of old gunmetal gray, which goes through there. absolute perfect note. And look at the way it relates to the colors in this print. And also, this print is stunning. She's got it up here, too. Look. Oh, God, I just love that. It's so abstract and so strange. It's very pronounced, but it's full of atmosphere and color. So it shakes up the whole structure of this thing, and we really do roll over the surface of it. And all of you have been so good about keeping very close toned. And can you see what that does to the color? How it makes it glow? Oh, yes, that's going to be the border. But just stunning. I love it that she brought in this kind of hot, kind of amber with the pink rose, and that kind of works in here. See, that's the thing is, you know, people are asking all the time how and why does that work? And we don't know. Who would have thought that would work? But you throw it in there, and suddenly, in the big context of this quill, it's the perfect note.
But also, how this outline picks up on that.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't pre-plan that.
No, exactly.
And the fungi.
The fans. People say, oh, you're picking that because it... No, I'm picking it because it was there and I thought maybe it would work. It's no little... You know, you guys all get very matchy-matchy in some of your thinking. Break out of that. I mean, there's not anything here that's matchy-matchy. It's all brilliantly... organic and inspirational. I find that these quilts are full of the unexpected. Even one that was almost entirely batiks is full of surprises. Who would think Tula Pink would come into the batik land and be perfectly at home? You know, those kind of things are what are so exciting, and keeping yourself open to that. Okay, did anybody learn anything today?
Oh, yeah.
And yesterday, you just explain to them just basic construction?
Yeah. You know, I always finish off class by saying this because I think it's important. And I'd already said it's not like adding water to a pack of soup and you get an instant soup. This is the start of your journey. We're still learning. We're not teachers. We're encouragers. The work that you're looking at here in this room is work that you have done. We might have just encouraged you and pushed you a little bit harder and further, but that's all we're doing is sharing our experience and our confidence. Some people are a little bit more intimidated than that, but it's just all about allowing you to have a go. How many of you actually work on a vertical surface when you're designing? Well, the rest of you are terrible women. Give yourselves a break, because what a difference. For those who haven't worked this way before, it makes a huge difference, doesn't it?
When I first started out, I used to put everything on the floor, fold it up in little handkerchief sizes, you know, try to visualize it sewn together. It was a nightmare, and so, which meant that every time someone sewed one of my quilts, I had to come in and say, oh, sorry, that whole bit is wrong, we've got to rip that out. And then I thought, there must be a better way. And then one day someone said, well, you know, there is this work wall. And I thought, how brilliant to be able to arrange it, make it look as if it's sewn together, and know that it's right.
But then also the work walls at the beginning were what color?
White.
White.
And when we were doing workshops, we'd say to people, bring a neutral color cloth, and they come with white. And it was like having a pair of false teeth in the glass. The wall was just covered in white. And, you know, it was a killer. These arrangements look fabulous because they're against a color that doesn't stop them from glowing in their own glory.
This cardboard's a great color too.
Do you want to know which is one of Kay's best-selling fabrics?
The
grey flannel. It's available on the Bolt, so you can have. I mean, some people say, "Well, I don't. You know, I got the Rembrandt, I got the Matisse. I don't have any room for my design board." Well, get an installation board. You can slip it behind the living room door, underneath the bed, or at the back of the couch when you don't want to. But you can pull it out, leave your work up. When you go shopping, you come back to school with fresh eyes.
What do you call it? It's an insulation wall?
Insulation board.
Well, yeah, like this board. These boards that we have in here, they are for sale. So they're $30 a piece or two for $50. And this is a construction board, and they're light enough to pick up. We're actually going to cut some of them in half and tape them together so that they will be hinged.
That's what we do. Is we have, at Liza's house, we have two of them. taped together.
So that I can, we can bring it out and just set it like a great big screen.
The one that's right there is taped together.
Yeah, so, so then you can arrange the whole quilt before you can sit down and sew, eliminate any mistakes that you need to, and go from there. Well, also, you know, we are still learning. We'll never stop learning. We didn't go to school to where we are now. We're literally both two self-taught artists. It's just that we have the confidence to just try something different or learn by our mistakes or be open. One of the quotes that I love to share with people is, mistakes leave room for opportunity. That's a very good one, particularly for me, because I make a lot of mistakes. But it leaves room for me to dance in other areas. What I like to say is that we're just a pebble being dropped in the water. It's really the ripples that go out and out and out. It's not what you've done today. It's what you're left thinking about, onwards and onwards and onwards. And how you will bring back and say and think to yourself, well, what did they say to me? Just have a go. Just, that's all you've done. Just do it. So you notice, all you're doing is flat the wall. You're not pulling on anything away. If you pull the flower away from the wall, your design work will fall down, and it's an awful sight. You just roll all the way up. So you just keep it flat to the wall, and then when you get home, it'll be in one piece for you to open up. So then you put that in your handbag.
Okay.
Put that in your handbag. That's all you need to do.
We're starting to get to it. Yeah, where are you going?